You might not be surprised to hear that the US Department of Defense participated in the production of movies like Black Hawk Down or Air Force One. But did you know that the Pentagon partially funded the first Iron Man movie? Or that they collaborated on the latest Wonder Woman film? You've heard about the military-industrial complex. Well, welcome to the military entertainment complex, the long historical partnership between the US Department of Defense and Hollywood. One of the most successful examples of this relationship goes all the way back to 1927, when the US military helped produce the film Wings, a war romance celebrated for the technical accuracy of its air combat scenes. The film won the first ever Academy Award, was a commercial and critical success, and led to a huge boost in recruitment. Elmer Davis, head of the Office of War Information in the 1940s, famously said, "The easiest way to inject a propaganda idea into most people's minds is to let it go through the medium of an entertainment picture, where they do not realize that they are being propagandized." A Freedom of Information Act request in 2017 revealed that the Department of Defense either funded or collaborated on over 800 films as far back as 1911, and backed 900 TV projects between 2005 and 2017 alone. So, how does it work? The inclusion of military hardware in a film is expensive, and even the biggest studios don't exactly have tanks, fighter jets, and technical advisors on hand. The Department of Defense is more than happy to help. Here's Phil Strub, former director of entertainment media at the DoD, talking about how projects are selected.
Our criteria is this production something that could increase the public's awareness or knowledge of the military and or help military recruiting and retention programs as well? It's deliberately broad. Mm-hmm. I mean, you can drive a train through criteria like that.
But it's not that simple. The DoD actually has very strict rules that give it a huge level of control over the film projects that it chooses to work on. This isn't some conspiracy theory. You can read about it on the DoD's own website. In their own words, the Department of Defense demands that films be in the national interest, assist recruitment, and in the case of historical films, be authentic in their portrayal of historical events. What is considered historically accurate and in the national interest is, of course, up to the DoD, not filmmakers.
This is our war, not yours.
Blackburn.
Date of birth?
2/27/75.
I was trained to fight. You trained to fight, Sergeant?
I was trying to make a difference.
Strub has admitted that the relationship between Hollywood and the Pentagon has been described as a mutual exploitation. We're after military portrayal, and they're after our equipment. While consulting on Jurassic Park 3, Strub personally suggested a surprise military rescue at the end of the film, which explains how these Marines appear out of nowhere. In the film Godzilla, Strub lobbied for an unsympathetic military character to be changed into an honorable all-American father.
Daddy's home.
Daddy's home.
Cake every night.
The Pentagon's film liaison unit can demand that scripts be watered down or changed, including characters and plot, as well as demanding a final say on the finished cut of a film. If filmmakers and studios aren't willing to comply, support can be withdrawn. This is what happened with the film Platoon, which the Pentagon considered overly critical of the Vietnam War. While the film Black Hawk Down is widely acknowledged to be a one-sided portrayal of US intervention in Somalia, there's a detail even most of its critics miss. Ewan McGregor plays the heroic ranger John Grimes, based on an actual soldier, John Stebbins. Stebbins was actually found guilty of the assault and rape of a girl under the age of 12. Mark Bowden, author of the Black Hawk Down book and screenplay, said he was explicitly pressured by the Pentagon to change the name of Stebbins' character. While he refused to do so in his book, he says he was ultimately forced to change it in the screenplay.
That's what you wanted, isn't it?
Hell yeah.
Strict agreements with studios and the ability to withdraw critical support gives the Department of Defense an incredible amount of power when it comes to shaping messages about the military for mass public consumption. But why has the US military recently been so interested in spending money on superhero and science fiction films? As audiences become more savvy, explicit pro-military messaging is harder to sell. Superhero and science fiction films present templates for simple good versus bad stories. And even if the stories are entirely fictional, having multiple, positive, uncritical depictions of the US military spread across popular culture is a powerful messaging tool for the Pentagon.
How do we know you won't one day act against America's interests?
I grew up in Kansas, General. About as American as it gets. Look, I'm here to help. But it has to be on my own terms. And you have to convince Washington of that.
Even if I were willing to try, what makes you think they'd listen?
I don't know, General. Guess I'll just have to trust you.
And fighting imaginary enemies allows for heroic depictions of the army without having to grapple with the reality of who it is the U.S. actually goes to war with in the real world.
Snipers, take out their eyes.
All right, demo team, let's crank steel.
These stories don't even need to be about war, as long as the military plays a fundamentally positive role in the story. In an age where cross-branding and marketing is ubiquitous, the Pentagon sees its relationship with Hollywood as mutually beneficial.
This man is not our enemy.
Thank you, Colonel.
Michael Bay's Transformers franchise is practically a glossy brochure for military hardware. Some of the film's shots linger on the beauty of Army, Navy, and Air Force technology, as much as they focus on the actual Transformers. Of course, what you won't see in these narratives is the true cost of American militarism, from illegal invasions and war crimes to mass destruction and the death and displacement of civilians. Nor will you see any references to the real risks of actually joining the US military, such as high rates of sexual harassment, suicide, and homelessness associated with being a soldier. And when it comes to the risks of being in combat, Hollywood often sells a simplified, depoliticized message of personal sacrifice and duty.
When I go home, people ask me, "Hey, Hoot, why do you do it, man? Why? You some kind of war junkie?" I won't say a goddamn word. Why? They won't understand. They won't understand why we do it. They won't understand it's about the men next to you. And that's it. That's all it is.
Collaborations between the military and Hollywood have been dubbed militainment. Let's take a look at some of the most popular and successful examples of this phenomenon. In the first Iron Man film, Tony Stark is a slick weapons manufacturer for the US military. The plot of the film revolves around him realizing how dangerous this is when his weapons fall into the hands of terrorists. The film is not explicitly about US intervention, at least not on the surface.
I don't want to see this on your MySpace page. Please, no gang signs. No, throw it up, I'm kidding. Yeah, peace. I love peace.
The US military is still ultimately presented as a legitimate force for good. In the end, Stark uses his technical knowledge to construct his Iron Man suit, effectively making himself a one-man army. His mission? To rescue innocent brown people from terrorists. And so, Iron Man effectively becomes a stand-in for the US military's rationale for foreign interventions.
What are you doing? A little knock and talk, making friends in Pakistan, what are you doing?
The sequels go even further, turning Colonel James Rhodes into his own version of Iron Man named War Machine and then Iron Patriot.
It tested well with focus groups, all right?
I am Iron Patriot.
Listen, War Machine was a little too aggressive, all right? This sends a better message.
The film is not above being tongue-in-cheek about militarism and branding, but stopped short of ever actually criticizing the military.
Yes, you're free, if you weren't before.
Captain America was a character deliberately created as propaganda. So how do you sell an idea like that to a modern audience?
Who will campaign door to door for America? Carry the flag shore to shore for America. From home open to Spokane. The Star-Spangled Banner with a plan.
The film cleverly and intentionally parodies this origin story. But again, the film only pokes fun at the style of propaganda used, not the fundamental function or role of the military. By making fun of explicit propaganda, the film allows audiences to ignore that they may still be absorbing a much more subtle, coded form of messaging about American values and supremacy. DC's Wonder Woman is played by Gal Gadot, a former member of the Israeli military. The franchise's supporting hero is also a United States Army captain. But besides the usual military glorification, the latest film in the franchise caused a different type of controversy. In the movie, Wonder Woman rescues Arab children playing soccer from being hit by a convoy of the movie's villains, also Arabs. Godot has famously been criticized for vocally supporting Israel's 2014 offensive against Gaza, which claimed over 1,000 civilian lives. During these attacks, 4 Palestinian boys on a Gaza beach were killed in an Israeli airstrike while playing soccer. The film essentially rewriting history to portray a bizarre inversion of a very particular set of tragic events caused understandable outrage. This is not to say that military partnerships and messaging in films are always subtle. Sometimes they can be completely obvious. In Captain Marvel, for example, the main character, Carol Danvers, is an actual Air Force pilot.
About to show these boys how we do it. You ready?
Higher, further, faster, baby.
That's right.
The film's message and advertising revolved around having a strong, driven female lead, and there was a direct recruitment campaign tied to the movie.
For you, what does it mean to see Captain Marvel up on the real screen, Carol Danvers, member of the Air Force?
I think it's pretty cool. It's like we're being represented by someone who plays and portrays us as someone amazing, you know? And we don't get that recognition often, so I think it's nice to see it on the big screen.
This X-Men film also had a direct recruitment campaign.
They stand together as an elite class. It's more than a uniform. It's a chance to be part of something bigger than you ever imagined.
And even the sequel to Independence Day created fake recruitment ads for the Earth Space Defense, which redirected people to an actual army recruitment site. These are just a few of the myriad ways in which the US military is able to project a particular mythology through popular film. Are these partnerships between the most powerful military on Earth and Hollywood, arguably the most powerful source of cultural production in the world, harmless? Is it just PR? Or is it propaganda?